And he says again, "You must move on or I will bury you." And I'm thinking, fucking. Hey everybody, I just can't control my fate. More on that later. Welcome to another episode of The Audiophiles. My name's John, his name is Andy, and we're here to listen to some music. Andy, what do you have for the class?
Well, I wanted to revisit a band that we had done within the last couple months, and it seemed that video is pretty well received by the masses, so especially when you apply that term to our channel. And I wanted to, I thought, oh well, that was a cover. I'd love to give you something of their original work, and this is one of my favorite songs by them. So I'm going to offer up another track by the Dave Matthews Band. And that track is called "Don't Drink the Water."
Okay, I shall go away and listen to Mr. Matthews and his entourage and tell you what I think.
Excellent, man.
Don't drink the water.
Some really strange flashes I'm getting from this. I don't know if I've heard this before. I don't think I have, but it sounds familiar and certain elements sound really familiar. I really like the sort of banjo playing in the playing with it. I don't know why, but it's almost given me a militaristic feel. And I guess if the drum's quite loose and he's you know, hitting those and beats here and there. If it was tighter, then it would sound really sort of, you know, military. And that bit just before when he sang, I wrote it down really quick, something about just room for me, something about lay your arms down, and it sort of goes higher. And yes, I will call this, and then I don't know what he says. It was really high. That sounded familiar as well to another song I've heard. I can't think what it is. It's sort of mid-80s. It'll come to me hours after I've done this, but yeah, it's got a nice feel to it. It's got a weird feel to it as well, and the way he's delivering it, slightly, I don't know if it's an easy, but it's not a breezy song. There's an edge to it, a kind of atmosphere. I'm not quite sure. It's early days. I'm not quite sure what it is. But it's got a really nice sound, and you know, those Bass licks you can hear as well. Yeah, very, very good. Okay, let's see how it goes.
Your land is gone and given me. And here I will spread my wings. Yes, I will call this
Sorry, I'm just trying to listen to the words. It says something about your land. And did he say, yes, I'll call this home? So it sounds like he's talking to someone else, but it sounds like, oh, something wrong. I've arrived and this is all mine. If it's American, then it's obviously Native American stuff. I don't know. All right, let's listen a bit more.
What's this you say? You feel the right to remain and stay, and I will. Say your father's spirit still lives in this place. Well, I will silence you. Here's the hitch, your horse is.
Stop it, I know. Sorry. it just sort of changed around about the 5 minute mark. It suddenly became a bit darker. The sort of fiddles were sort of a lower register, and his voice changed to a bit more sort of growly and a bit more attack in it and a bit more tension. And then this female, I think it's female, it's a higher register anyway. I'm sure it's female vocals behind sort of singing. And he did this, the little touches that made me think that this is something to do with Native Americans, because he vocalized a bit there and it sounded like a almost like a Native American sort of chanting. And again, there's this intensity here that kind of reminds me a bit of that, the way she's singing as well. She's not just echoing the lines, but there is an urgency to her voice and a bit of intensity as well. It's really interesting. Yeah, interesting. So it wasn't a normal song, verse, chorus, verse, chorus, bridge, chorus, another chorus again, just in case you missed it. It wasn't one of those. It was all of one piece, and yeah, I'm fine with that completely. And they just threw in bits instrumentally to change it slightly and have a different sound, and it was kind of developing, and then it took a right, Clyde. Yeah, I've just found myself really listening to the vocals and trying to grab them, grab some. I will make sense of it or try to. Yeah, I just get a strong feeling. We was talking a lot about land and taking stuff. I mean, shit, it could be the land grab of Eastern Europe by Hitler for all I know, but I think it's Native Americans. But Andy will set me right and show me the error of my ways, I'm sure. So let's go back and talk to the fella. Okie dokie.
All
Here I
right.
am once again.
All right. So, what did you think of this tune, Don't Drink the Water?
Yeah, like you said, I was interested to hear a sort of piece of original music from them, because I know the band's musical proficiency was demonstrated in that previous video, so I know they've got the skills to pay the bills, as the Beastie Boys would say. But so I was really interested to hear an original. So this is an interesting song, and it's not a usual structure, verse, chorus, verse, chorus, bridge, chorus again, verse, chorus twice more, just in case you hadn't got it the first five times. And not one of those, no. So it kind of kicks straight in. I mean, I think he says the title and then it's bang straight to the song, and there's no warm up or anything. It's a really nice sound to it. I particularly liked the banjos. I say banjos, I presume there's more than one, it might just be one, but I always think of them traveling in packs.
They are
Probably
back at
from because of Deliverance. but it gives a certain richness to the music. And I immediately thought that if the beat had been a touch quicker, then it would have almost had a sort of antiquated American Civil War sort of military feel to it in a way. And I think that's just me. But, those sort of signals come out with that sort of stuff, and particularly with the fiddles as well. And I really like the way at the start they were finishing each line of him singing. But I did feel, bear with me on this, because this isn't contemporaneous to the song, so I'm gonna have to, my notes are all over the shop. I was scribbling on every corner of the page, so they're not in order. But I did feel there's a touch of uneasiness to this, and I was trying to work out why this is all was happening in the first 30, 40 seconds in my head. I will just, before I go into that, just say brilliant bass cameos throughout the whole song. Real lovely flourishes and licks here and there. The drums, really steady beat. And then what he did again, this song just built. The whole song did, and every person and part in it did. But he starts to put some seasoning in at the drummer. There's really small fills and stutter beats, and then these hits of the hi-hat and the cymbals as well, that were just, again, just little marker pen highlights to little bits of the song. Really liked it. I started to feel there was an odd familiarity to the song, but it is just a, you know, passing by someone at 30 miles an hour in a car thinking, did I go to school with him? Oh well, you know, it was that sort of familiarity. It wasn't
Sure.
really. His voice sounded like he was holding back, which he was. We find out later. And it kind of adds to the uneasy atmosphere, because at this point I'm picking up some of the lyrics, not a lot, but picking up some. And it kind of felt like someone who starts threatening you but says it really quietly, which is a little bit more off-putting than if they shouted in
Isn't it?
your face. So something is off in my mind. And here's some of the lyrics that I scribbled down and picked up. So he said, just room for me, you will lay your arms down, land is gone. This may not be accurate. Here I will spread my wings. Yes, I will call this home. I had about three bites of cherry before I got that, because he's saying it high. I will bury you. And I'm thinking, oh dear. So initially I thought, because there was other things about fire and stuff, you know. So I thought, this sounds like, the first thing in my head was land grab. Now, it could easily be Hitler's Anschluss and then the annexation of Poland, but I don't think it was. It doesn't have to be a specific event, obviously, because he's just, you know, singing. But with what was going on and with the music as well, my first thing popped into my head was Native Americans. It could have or it couldn't be, but that's what in my head. And then as soon as that was in, I couldn't get rid of it. And the lyrics and the music started to seem even darker because of the way they're delivered. It was almost like he's talking about what's going to happen, like it's a fait accompli, you know, with a tiny hint of threat to any resistance, but almost like he's not taking any resistance seriously as well. Like, we'll just fucking wipe you out if you know, even answer back. That sort of thing. So, yeah, I really like the way he sung in the beginning, the certain lines where he went higher at the end, where he says, yes, I will call this home. And then he goes up high. Again, sorry, this isn't in order, but I think it might be, but sorry if it isn't. Then he does a little section where he keeps saying what that you say a lot. And in that section, the fiddles start really swirling. And it's like, in my mind, it was like campfire smoke. You know, it's almost disorientating. They're really getting active, and there's this hint of what's to come. And in the next section, the guitars, I can only describe that excellent. I can only describe it all like a soaring action, the way they're sort of playing, really almost percussive. They're really, really lovely sounding. And he says again, you must move on or I will bury you. And I'm thinking, fucking. Around the 5 minute mark, there's this shift. His voice becomes more expansive and then almost animated. And he's definitely starting to sing proper full belt. And it almost becomes a rant. You know, there's a touch more emotion in his voice, but it's almost like, I don't know if it's indignant or if it's anger, but there's something there. And then behind his vocals, at this point, I kind of was listening to them, but not taking them in, because I was just, everything was going on. But there's a female, I'm sure it's a female, might not be, but there's a high register voice behind singing And I don't know what she was singing, but there's almost a wailing quality, which in my mind evokes American natives again. There was an intensity and an urgency. It was much, much darker sounding. The fiddle sounded really ominous now. I guess it's that beauty of proper classical music that the various instruments could have different sort of, characteristics. And at this point, really, really well done. He then sings, it's coming to a conclusion, and he sings, "There's blood in the water." And it's really, assault is too strong a word perhaps, but it's really hammer it in at this point. And when he said there's blood in the water, it me immediately made me think of the Rwandan genocide, and all the thousands of bodies that sort of bled into Lake Victoria and, made it unusable for weeks, which is a lovely image to have in my head at that point. So this is a really powerful atmospheric piece. I enjoyed it a lot and I was very impressed with it. I'm not sure it's a song that I'd readily reach to and put on the radio. Depends on my mood. But that's not to take away anything from it. It was really impressive, very enjoyable. Yeah, top stuff.
Awesome, man. I'm so glad you liked it. Yeah, it's definitely one of my favorite Dave Matthews songs. And it is incredibly powerful. It is incredibly unsettling and gruesome and evocative. And
And
it
I miss
sounds.
loads of words as well, so it's probably even worse.
We'll get into those, don't you worry. But yeah, let me get into it a little bit with you. So Don't Drink the Water was released as the first single from the Dave Matthews Band 1998 album entitled Before These Crowded Streets. And the song features banjo playing by Bella Fleck of Bella Fleck and the Flecktones. I'm not sure if you're familiar with them, but wildly popular world musicians. And the wailing he, she, it that you described was provided by none other than Alanis Morissette, who is featured on this song and another on this album. So yeah.
Or God, as she's known by Kevin Smith,
Yeah, it depends. Yeah, what film you're
or the
watching,
film
but
Dogma.
yeah, exactly. So yeah, Before These Crowded Streets was a critical and commercial success. The album debuted at the top of the Billboard 200, selling 421,000 units in its first week of release. And it knocked off the Titanic soundtrack from the top of the chart after a 16 consecutive week run. So this is who saved us
Doing
from
good
that.
work as well,
Yes,
then.
exactly. So even more of a reason. Don't get me wrong, that's a beautiful song by Celine Dion and all that, but I mean, come on. When we were like, that song was everywhere and I needed to escape it. And this really good album, in my opinion, supplanted it. So all that much more reason to love it. There were three
I
singles
hated
released.
that song. I fucking hated that song. But anyway.
I think it's one of those, like, if you went through something that helps you connect with that song means the world to you. I didn't, so it was just kind of sappy to me. So yeah, I kind of tend to agree with you, but not wanting to ruffle any feathers out there.
No problem with
There,
that. No problem with that at all.
yeah, different tact, right? There were three singles released from that album, Don't Drink the Water, which we just listened to, Stay, Wasting Time, parenthetically, and Crush, all of which received varying levels of commercial success. The album was a four-time platinum hit, selling over 4 million copies. It marked a shift in the band's sound, having much darker themes, as we just heard, and textures and more complex arrangements. Certain songs see the band apply polyrhythms and Middle Eastern scales. This track reached number 50 on the US Billboard Hot 100 Airplay, number 4 on the US Billboard Modern Rock Track, and number 19 on the US Billboard Mainstream Rock Tracks. So that's a little bit about, we've talked about
It's
the band in the other video. So if you want to learn more about the individuals and everything, you can ch check that out. But what were you going to say, John? I'm sorry.
I was saying, not surprised. It's an excellent song, but it's not really radio friendly, is it?
Yeah.
You're
This
not
ain't
going to
rock
switch
and
it
pop
on
or
during
something like that.
during drive time. Oh, I hope they put on that genocide song.
Yeah,
As I'm going to pick the kids up from school,
Precisely. So I'm going to jump into the lyrics before I go on a little bit further, with some more information. But the lyrics are, "Don't drink the water. Come out, no use in hiding. Come now, can you not see? There's no place here, what were you expecting? No room for both, just room for me. So you will lay your arms down. Yes, I will call this home. Away, away, you have been banished. Your land is gone and given to me. And here I will spread my wings. Yes, I will call this home. What's this you say? You feel a right to remain? Then stay, and I will bury you. What's that you say? Your father's spirit still lives in this place? I will silence you. Here's the hitch. Your horse is leaving. Don't miss your boat. It's leaving now. And as you go, I will spread my wings. Yes, I will call this home. I have no time to justify to you, fool. You're blind. Move aside for me. All I can say to you, my new neighbor, is you must move on, or I will bury you. Now, as I rest my feet by this fire, those hands once warmed here, I have retired them. I can breathe my own air. I can sleep more soundly upon these poor souls. I'll build heaven and call it home, 'cause you're all dead now. I live with my justice. I live with my greedy need. I live with no mercy. I live with my frenzied feeding. I live with my hatred. I live with my jealousy. I live with the notion that I don't need anyone but me. Don't drink the water. There's blood in the water." So those are the lyrics.
Listening to them, particularly the start, because it does get more, emotional towards the end. But the start is, it's the words of a bully, isn't it? And it just makes you fucking angry when you hear them. It really does.
Yes, it does. In a somewhat recent GQ interview, Dave Matthews said of this song, "People close to me ask me, what is the best song you ever wrote? And I name this song each and every time. I've nothing to apologize for in that. Why am I mad about the history of North America? The thing I am maddest about is all of the knowledge, culture, and perspective that we erased for greed. The idea of conquering people is deeply misguided, arrogant, and stupid. I realized the best way to convey that was to become the villain for this song. That's the part I like so much about the song. Where are the skulls I have to crush? Because all of this is mine." Matthews was born in apartheid South Africa and moved to Virginia in the United States when he was a child. And I think it's interesting that he comes from a place rooted in a history that's steeped in racial inequity. And then he arrives at what was the capital of the Confederacy and lives there and has and bears the weight of knowing the histories of both places he's called home his whole life. And I mean, this is clearly about the Native American genocide and the European colonization of America and the atrocities committed. And it's just really powerful to me. And probably since my college days, I've played this song every single Thanksgiving. As just not for people, not to throw it in their faces, but just for me, because it's like it's just incredible how we got here and what we did to get here and what was lost or sacrificed in order to get here and whose heads we had to step on to get where we are. And I don't want to, sound like some, bleeding heart or whatever, but history's history and, you don't want to forget where you came from and how you got to where you are. So as I enjoy the comforts of modern living and, living in a very first world country that's, atop the pecking order of hegemony and all this stuff, you got to remember your roots. So this is a really fucking amazing song to me, and it's I'm one of those people that, as you joked about, like, oh, I'm not going to turn this as a drive time radio or whatever. But for me, there is like a lot of beauty in tragedy. And I don't want that to be flippant in regard to those who suffered, for me to be able to sit here and enjoy it. But it still really, really makes your noodle work. And I love to think about this stuff. And it's just good. I'm glad that there are artists out here that are capturing this kind of stuff and putting these kind of perspectives to music and putting this message out there. So yeah, this is one of my all-time favorite Dave Matthews Band songs.
Yeah, a couple of points from that sort of spring to mind. I think one is, there are details in this, obviously, but this could apply to any situation across the globe.
And you named a few in your initial interpretation, right? You mentioned Rwanda. Yeah. You mentioned the annex of Poland.
Yeah, right. And you know, our country probably is top of the league. You know, we're not top of anything anymore, but in terms of buggering up other countries, we're up there. You know, and you could say India, Africa, not so much, you know, Southern American continent, Australia, Canada, the list goes on and on and on, you know. And all those places had an indigenous population that was either shat on or wiped out or completely... you know, used and abused. You know, here's some shiny beads. Let's take all your minerals and your gold and everything else. And we'll take your national treasures as well. Put them in a glass case back in London. And you can beg for the next 200 years before you get them back, you know, all that sort of stuff. So, yeah. And it's interesting. And I know from, this is really a little tangent, but last year, was it? Time flies, but when they did the television series of The Watchmen, which they sort of reimagined, the guys who created it were talking about, they wanted to talk about the history of Black America, particularly the sort of movement through, was it the 1910s, 1920s, and a part of history which is not really talked about much in America or recognized. And it's, you know, and it's the same with the Native Americans as well, you know, from the very start, I mean, Thanksgiving, as you say, through to the smallpox blankets and then the just systematic taking of land through a military action, you know, later on. It's not really spoken about much at all. So it is good that someone's... you know, at least do it. And the great beauty about, people say it's always a joke, someone talking about a serious issue in a 5 minute song or whatever, but the beauty of popular culture is that it will last longer than a speech someone made in a town hall, and people are still talking about the ramifications of strange fruit, you know, 100 years, not nearly, you know, a good 80-90 years after that song was released. So these things do stick around, and it will hit people, but it will hit people individually rather than in a big group or a rally like in Nuremberg or something. Not that we want that, but yeah, you know what I mean. So it's great that he's done, you know, said this, and it's interesting his mindset, like you said, coming from South Africa into southern states and then seeing what's going on around him.
Exactly. And it's interesting too, because like, it's not just the English that have their fingerprint on this. It's also the Spanish too. And,
and the French and the Portuguese.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And it's interesting because like when we talked about the live Central Park, concert, and I had mentioned that they do that, you know, Watchtower wasn't the only cover that they did, that they also had done Cortez the Killer, which is the only other great song about ravishing indigenous people in the Western Hemisphere that really comes to mind when I think about that, like songs of that ilk. So it's like, here's the song that they've covered and here's the song that they've written. And one of them is very much South Central American centric, and the other is very much Canada and the United States centric, and how it dealt with the, you know, Europeans just raping and pillaging the natives in those areas. So, yeah, he's very, aware of this stuff. And it's good to see that in artists, that they're not all just out here talking about having money and girls and cars and love and all this stuff. It's, there's other heavier, headier stuff that can be discussed. So I am really thankful that you went off and gave this a listen. And I'm glad that I think it hit with you as much as it did. Awesome. Guys out there in the listening audience, let us know what you thought of Don't Drink the Water by Dave Matthews Band. If the song, you know, if it evoked anything in you, what it was, if it reminded you of anything, if you liked, disliked it, whatever. Comments field is there for you, and we love to catch you guys in there. All that being said, if you enjoyed this video or any of the others that we put out, feel free to like, share, and subscribe. We really do appreciate you guys helping us bolster our numbers and our presence here on YouTube. And until next time, John and I will see you on the next episode of The Audio Files. See you later, guys.